we have here in verse 9 this language, and I want you to listen to it very carefully because it's very important. And it's this: rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem, behold, thy king cometh unto thee, for he is just and having salvation. And by the way, salvation can better be translated victory, because deliverance would be victory of a king coming to deliver. He's just and having victory, lowly and riding upon an ass and upon a colt, the foal of an ass. Now, if you want to read how that is quoted in the gospel record, you'll find it first in Matthew 21, verse 5. And I think probably I should turn over and read that. And if you'll note that there is quite a difference between what you have in Zechariah, what you have in Matthew, and it's caused some to say this was a misquotation of prophecy. Well, I don't know why people like that, of course, they're looking to try to find errors in the Bible, why they don't study it and see why it's quoted differently. Now, I'd like to read what Matthew has to say. Tell ye the daughter of Zion, behold, thy king cometh unto thee, meek and sitting upon an ass, and a colt the foal of an ass. Now, there's certain parts of that prophecy that are not quoted. Only that part which Matthew quotes is the part that was fulfilled, and that the other part waits the second coming of Christ to the earth. Now, may I go back to the Gospel of John, because John likewise quotes in John 12, verse 15, and here he quotes it like this: fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, thy king cometh sitting on an ass's colt. And that's all that John gives. Now, why is that abridged and abbreviated as it is? Well, we're going to find that that portion which is quoted in the New Testament was fulfilled at the first coming of Christ, and the other will be fulfilled at the second coming of Christ. Now, it actually was not a triumphal entry. It really was a triumphant exit that he made when he was here before. That was the thing that the church, I think, has miscalled it. And then I want to call attention to something else. He didn't come in just one day in the so-called triumphal entry. He came in 3 days. Now, you'll find, if you consult the Gospels rather carefully, for instance, in Mark, the 11th chapter, verse 11, I'll not turn to this now, you'll find out that he came in first on the Sabbath day, Saturday. We talk about Palm Sunday, there's Palm Saturday too. But he came in as a king. He came in, he didn't do a thing in the world, Mark says, that he just looked about the temple and the city. The money changers were not there. It was the Sabbath day. He came in as the king, and he rejected the city and temple. He said and did nothing. He went out, he wept over the city of Jerusalem, but as the king. Then he came in the second day, and it was Sunday, and that was Palm Sunday. The money changers were in the temple, and he cleansed the temple. He came in that day as a priest, and you'll find that in Matthew 21, verse 12. He came in as the priest. Then on Monday, he came in the third time. On the way in, he cursed the fig tree. And Matthew 21, verse 23 tells us that he taught in the temple. He came in as the prophet of God. He came in as a king, as a priest, and a prophet. And every instructed Israelite knew what he was doing. He was presenting himself as the Messiah. And now, was he meek and humble because he rode on that little donkey? And my answer is no. He was meek but not because he rode on that little donkey. Now, I would like also to turn to the Gospel of Matthew. Although all the Gospel writers record the triumphal entry, it's only Matthew who quotes from Zechariah. Now, John gives a rather running commentary on the prophecy of Zechariah. Instead of saying rejoice, he says fear. And actually, that is a good sound interpretation. So that Matthew is the one. And therefore, I want to turn to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 21, verse 1. And let me read this record because it's rather important for what we have to say today. And I'm reading now, and when they drew nigh unto Jerusalem and were come to Bethphage, unto the Mount of Olives, then sent Jesus two disciples, saying unto them, go into the village over against you, and straightway ye shall find an ass tied, a colt with her. Loose them and bring them unto me. And if any man say aught unto you, ye shall say, the Lord hath need of them, and straightway he'll send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, tell ye the daughter of Zion, behold, thy king cometh unto thee, meek, and sitting upon an ass, and a colt the foal of an ass. Now you'll notice he gives it to us, tell ye the daughter of Zion. And he leaves out, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. And you'll also note that Matthew leaves out, he is just and having salvation, and the better translation, I think, is victory. He is just and having deliverance or victory. Now, you have here these two omissions. And why did Matthew leave them out? Was it because he just didn't quote accurately, or because he didn't know? I think not. I believe in the verbal plenary inspiration of the Scriptures. And I believe Zechariah knew what he was doing because he was writing by the Spirit of God. And I think Matthew knew what he was doing, was writing by the Spirit of God. Now, I'm not going to read any farther in Matthew's record, although I'll refer to it now. And so I want you to look at this verse today with us as a text. I was in San Francisco the night General Douglas MacArthur arrived from Japan. I'm sure many of you recall that. It was after World War II, and a long time after World War II had ended. And he was whisked from the airport to the hotel in a rather, they thought, private, or at least a semi-private march from the airport to the hotel. Well, there was a public demonstration that snarled traffic. I'd been warned that afternoon by a friend as I was leaving that night on the train to return back to Los Angeles. He said, you better get down to the train if you intend to catch it, and you ought to go now. Well, I actually took my suitcase down and checked it, and then I came back up into San Francisco and had dinner. And when I came out, I have never seen such a crowd in all my life. And there was a public demonstration that had snarled traffic. And I had to walk from the Civic Center down to the railroad station. I got in a taxi, but he got tied up, and I told him I could make better time walking, and he agreed. And so I got out and walked to the station, the only way I would have made it. And the next day, I was told they had a real triumphal entry, and it was repeated later in New York City. Now, if the so-called triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem 1,900 years ago were compared to this, may I say it would seem very puerile, penury, and poor. It was really, 1,900 years ago, a parade of poverty. It was not a ticker parade by any means whatsoever. It was the coming in of a very poor man with very poor followers. And if there'd been a Roman in Jerusalem that time, and he had stepped out of the building he was in, and have asked somebody in the parade what's going on. They'd have said, this is the triumphal entry of Jesus. And he said, you think this is a triumphal entry? You ought to have been in Rome when Caesar got back from Gaul. It was a parade there that lasted for over 3 days of him bringing the booty and the captive back. And if you think this is triumphal, why, you should have seen that one, and you'd see how poor and beggarly this one really is. I think, frankly, the church has misnamed it, the triumphal entry. Christ never intended it to be a triumphal entry. It actually marks a crisis in his life, a life that was filled with crises. It marks a change of tactics. Heretofore, he'd slipped into the city silently. He'd entered unobtrusively. He sought the shadows, no publicity, always withdrawing from the crowd, not courting attention. It was said that he would not cry or strive or cause his voice to be heard in the street. He entered by the sheep gate and came in and eluded the mob and evaded the crowd. And even when he would perform a miracle, he would put a hush-hush on it. And now there's a right about face. It seems that there's an inconsistency here. Now he comes out into the open. He enters publicly. He demands attention. He requires a decision. And he forces the issue. For one brief moment, the nation must consider him. And the Pharisees were accurate when they said, the world's gone after him. Jerusalem was stirred when he came in. Now, in spite of this forward thrust, this reversal in tactics, pushing himself into the front, he was meek, we're told. Matthew lifts that out of the text that he was quoting from Zechariah, that he was lowly and riding upon an ass and upon a colt, the foal of an ass. And Matthew says, tell the daughter of Zion, behold, thy king cometh unto thee meek, and sitting upon an ass and a colt, the foal of an ass. Now, these striking omissions that we have here, actually, these omissions are something to note and something to register, by the way. Matthew doesn't quote everything that is there. And he leaves out, rejoice and shout, O daughter of Zion. Why, he says, tell the daughter of Zion. And it says he is just and having victory. And he leaves that out. Why? Well, let's look at it. He does include he's meek. And it is assumed by those who read it, since it says in connection with it, that he is riding upon this little animal, a donkey, and everyone assumes that little donkey is an animal that denotes meekness. Far from it. That little donkey was the animal that kings rode upon. You see, the horse was the animal of warfare, and so used in Scripture. The little donkey is the animal that kings rode upon that were seeking peace. And when they were at peace, it was a royal animal, by the way. And if you go back to the book of Judges, the 10th chapter, verses 3 and 4, and then again in the 12th chapter, verse 13, you will find that the judges provided donkeys for their children to ride upon. That was quite a thing in that day. One of the judges had about 20 boys, and he got all of them a donkey to ride upon. That's like getting him a, in the old days, would have been a Stutz Bearcat, and today it would be one of the sport models that we have, a car. After all, the little donkey was quite a royal animal. You know, today with the sports job, you can have the top back or you can have the top up. And in that day, this little animal, you could have his ears down or the ears up on the little donkey. It's the animal that kings rode upon. And the thought of Zechariah is that in spite of the fact he's riding in as a king, denoting peace, that he is still meek and lowly. Now, there's another wrong impression that needs to be corrected, I think, relative to this so-called incident. And Bible teachers in Great Britain and Europe have recognized largely that there were three times that he came in a triumphal entry. He came in first on the Sabbath day, that was Saturday, came in then on Sunday, and then he came in on Monday. And I think that the scripture bears that out. For instance, he came in the first time on the Sabbath day, and he came in as a king. And Mark says in Mark the 11th chapter, in verse 11, and Jesus entered into Jerusalem and into the temple, and when he had looked round about upon all things, and now the eventide was come, he went out unto Bethany with the 12. First time he came in, he just looked around. The money changers weren't there. It was the Sabbath day. And he just looked around, and his very action is that of rejecting it. He came in as a king, and that's Palm Saturday, if you please. Then there's Palm Sunday, came in the first day of the week. The money changers were in the temple, and he cleansed the temple on that day, and you'll find that he came in as a priest. And Matthew makes it very clear. I didn't read all of the record in the 21st chapter of Matthew, but if you drop down to verse 12, it says, and Jesus went into the temple of God, cast out all them that sold and bought in the temple, and overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves. This is the only action that he ever performed as a priest when he was here upon this earth. And that, my friend, is something that's quite remarkable. But may I say to you that the writer to the Hebrews made it very clear he was never a priest here on earth. In Hebrews 8:4 it says, for if he were on earth, he should not be a priest, seeing that there are priests that offer gifts according to the law. But no priest ever dared cleanse the temple, and he did, and that was his only action. And he did that when he came in on that Sunday. Then he came back in on Monday. And on the way in, he cursed the fig tree. Mark says in Mark 11, verse 12, and on the morrow, when they were come from Bethany, was hungry, saw a fig tree, cursed it. And he tells about the cleansing of the temple on that day also, but also moves on down. And we are told again by Matthew in chapter 21, verse 23, it says, when he was coming to the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came unto him as he was teaching and said, by what authority doest thou these things, and who gave thee this authority? He came in on the third day as God's prophet. He's teaching. He's speaking for God. And every objection at that time, and he silenced the enemies, and his was the voice of God. Not only said, he that hath seen me hath seen the Father, but he that hath heard me hath heard the Father. He certainly did that in action. So that you have here the fact that he came in three times. That makes this rather important. Now the final appearance before the nation in his threefold office as prophet, priest, and king. Now was he making an entry? No, he was making an exit, not an entrance. He was not arranging to take up residence in Jerusalem and reign. He sent them in to arrange for a place for the Passover. But he never said, let's rent an apartment for 3 years. He was getting ready not to enter, not to become the king, but he was entering to prepare for his exit. He was preparing for his passion, for his suffering, for his death, passing through the portals of death. And his entrance into Jerusalem was not a one-way ticket. It was a round-trip ticket. And part of the program which led to Calvary and his death, his resurrection, his ascension, his intercession, his coming again, and also as the king. The fact of the matter is, the trail of triumph cannot be confined or limited to a ride on a little donkey from Bethany to Jerusalem. It's only a minor segment of a trip that began in eternity past when he was the Lamb of God slain before the foundation of the world. And it extends into eternity future. And when you see it in those terms, it becomes meaningful. And it's meaningless without seeing it like that. The one who came out of eternity is the one that came into Jerusalem. For thus saith the high and lofty one that inhabiteth eternity, whose name is holy. Isaiah 57:15, and then in Psalm 92, even from everlasting to everlasting thou art God. That is, from the vanishing point to the vanishing point, he's God. And so he came in like that. Now the church calls it a triumphal entry. I don't think so. I think that it's a triumphal exit. Because, as Bishop Rule says, that crowd that followed him, that said Hosanna, they never thought of him as the Son of God, the Savior of the world. Well, that same crowd that said Hosanna one day said crucify him the next day. I think one of the most interesting pictures that's ever been painted was painted by an artist that I do not know his name. And he paints a little donkey. And the little donkey is chewing on some palm fronds. And there are three crosses in the background. May I say to you, that tells the story. It wasn't a triumphal entry. It was a triumphal exit. 6 months beforehand, he set his face steadfastly to go to Jerusalem to die. And he moved by a prearranged program and a vowed arrangement, a definite decision. Nothing was accidental. Nothing left to chance. That little donkey was arranged for. The upper room had been reserved. And he came in on schedule. Got on the plane in London, and the captain came on when we took off, and he said, we will be landing in Los Angeles 12 hours from now at a certain time. And may I say that we winged our way across that wide waste of the Atlantic and a cloud cover over Iceland, and then came down over Greenland and finally saw part of the coast of Greenland. And it looked like an ice box to me in deep freeze. And also across Canada and the wastes there covered with snow. And finally, we came into the lugubrious climate of Southern California right on schedule. And when he came into Jerusalem, he'd come out of eternity, friends. And he's going into eternity. So he's not making an entry. He's making an exit. He's going by the cross. That was his destination, and the empty tomb was not, though, the destination. And the empty tomb was a goal. Oh, no, it was not his goal. The ascension did not end his story, and he makes a triumphal exit. And that's the reason that Paul could write that when he ascended, he led captivity captive, and he could say to a thief, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. May I say to you, we can sing today, looking into the future when he's coming back as a king, because he had a round-trip ticket, by the way. Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem downs all music but its own. Awake, my soul, and sing of him who died for thee, and hail him as the matchless king through all eternity. And all I can say at the triumphal entry, I bow before him as my Savior and my Lord.